part of the Press Play Podcast Network.
Look up in the sky. It's a bird. It's a plane.
This is Jason J. Lewis, the voice of Superman on Justice League Action.
This is Mark Waid, writer of Superman Birdlight.
You're listening to The Krypton Report.
Welcome to the Krypton Report podcast. I'm your host, Tyler, the Superman of Blue, the Man of Tomorrow, and with me is the Man of Steel himself, the Superman of Red, Mr. James Cole. What's up, man?
Hey, what's up, Tyler?
Man, it's good to hear from you. I feel like I haven't heard from you in a while.
It's not been that long. I mean, we check in, make sure we're doing good with each other, but some days we just don't get to chat, you know?
I know, it's weird. I've talked about this a little bit in the past episode. I've realized that to me, like, podcasting with my friends and chatting with you and doing this, it's like therapy, man. It's like therapeutic. It's like a much needed, it's kind of like our version of like guys night.
Pretty much.
It's the closest we get, you know, with the distance. Speaking of guys night, crack a cold one. Zoa.
Well, I actually got some margarita.
Nice. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I got the Zoa because, well, you know, Janita sent me to the gas station right before we started to get her one because she's got some schoolwork to finish up.
So
I was like, okay.
Well, then why not? One. Yeah.
Yeah, they're 2 for $4. So this isn't the Zoa podcast, though we would be sponsored by Zoa or Cherry Coke or anyone. I will blatantly take money and talk up your product no matter what it is. I'm not shallow at all.
No, not at all. Not in the least.
Hey, we got some stuff to talk about, so let's jump into some news here. All right, first thing of news. So Gotham Knights has ended, okay? And we did see Misha Collins' face as Two-Face. That's a moment of silence for Two-Face, because I haven't watched it yet because I was kind of waiting for it to drop on HBO Max. So I could watch the episode without all the CW breaks, you know?
Yeah. That's how I plan on watching it. It's one season, a handful of episodes.
Turn it on the background. I've already watched like the first 3. So I'll just turn it on the background while I'm folding laundry or spanking my children when they're, you know, in trouble. Just joking. But his like Two-Face looks like Nemesis from Resident Evil's face, like half of it, like kind of what I feel like.
It does look very similar to something like that. It looks like their idea was, you know, melted flesh, I guess. Maybe a little too Freddy Krueger on one side.
Maybe. Like, it looks odd. Like, I'm sorry. Like, I've said this before. Love Two-Face. Favorite Batman villain. Okay? And I liked Aaron Eckhart a lot. Just not enough of him. And now we have our third Two-Face in live action, and I still feel...
Yeah. Even with Aaron Eckhart in The Dark Knight, that symmetry was still there, you know? It was very like split down the middle, how his burns were. Yeah. And this one is not. It's its very own take. I definitely have to see it in action. It's not my favorite look for Two-Face. I mean, it's right up there with Tommy Lee Jones's purple face. But
yeah, at least that made some sense in the context of the movie.
Yeah, like, yeah.
So I don't know about Two-Face. We'll see. We'll watch it and we'll come back and talk about it more. We got more important things to talk about. Like, for example, The Flash.
I was going to say, the only reason we're talking about that is you're such a fan of Two-Face.
Yeah, we try to cover all DC. The Flash will be released digitally on 7/18.
Man, so that's fast.
It not really. I mean, it's a month. It's over a month. It's a month and 2 days. So the Flash coming out's 30 days. I mean, Fast X just recently did that. Black Adam, I think, was one of the first ones to do that. That's why it felt so, or was it, was under 30 days, wasn't it?
Black Adam was really fast. Between that and Super Pets, they both came out in like record time.
I feel like Super Pets was like 3 weeks. Black Adam and Shazam are like 3 weeks. So the Flash on digital in a month makes sense. I'm surprised it's not faster, honestly. Like this week for 4th of July, they're like, drop the Flash digitally.
that would because, be like extra fast.
I mean, it's just as bad as it's doing, but yeah, so we'll we might have a watch party for that, or we might do that for our commentary next month, or this month, I mean. But speaking of the Flash, did you see this? The Flash Escape from the Midnight Circus is a new podcast drama. Did you see this?
I did, yes.
The first two parts of the podcast were released on Monday, July 10th, exclusively on Apple Podcasts, with the remaining episodes dropping weekly on each subsequent Monday. The studio says the first four episodes will be exclusive to Apple for a limited time before branching out to other podcast providers. Max Greenfield, a.k.a. Schmidt from New Girl, will be The Flash. I don't know if it's Barry or Wally, but just said The Flash in the press release.
Yeah, I don't recall if they specified at all. I don't think they did in that teaser trailer that was released.
Yeah, I've watched it a couple of times because I was trying to get as much information. I'm excited. I think it's neat. I think it's supposed to be like some sort of connected material to the film I read, but we'll see how that is. You know, the last one, the Harley Quinn one, I haven't finished. I have like one or two episodes left. The one with Christina Ricci as Harley Quinn. Okay. And then the Batman Unburied was okay. Like, it was just okay. Those were on Audible. So it just seems like these podcast dramas are kind of like modern day, almost like radio shows episodes. It's kind of neat.
Yeah. Yeah. It's definitely something neat.
So I look forward to that. I'll be checking that out. It's like next week or the week after. Yeah, next week. Yeah. Happy 4th of July, by the way, James.
Yes, happy 4th.
Please don't blow off anything that you need.
I don't plan on blowing up too much. It is my mom's birthday, though.
Oh, yeah, you can blow some stuff up. On a weird side note, I also built some really cheap makeshift shelves today to help display my Superman figures, to help space them out so you can see them better, and to build more space for new figures, because that's obviously a thing that I'm into now. I'm a man in my 30s instead of addicted to cars or drugs or women, or so I'm addicted to comics and collectible toys.
Right. Yeah, there are much worse things to be addicted to than comics and toys.
I'm a catch. So here's some sad news, and I probably should have started with this before I swim back to toys. But the body of Julian Sands has been discovered, and he is officially passed away. Julian Sands, the actor that played Jor-El in season 9 of Smallville. So it's kind of sad, since it was a very tragic accident that took his life, hiking or something like that.
Yeah, 65, I believe.
So I just wanted to mention that. Now back to something happy. McFarlane is releasing their Action Comics number 1 figure.
That's awesome.
I'm excited. I'm going to get it. It looks awkward, but I just love the Action Comics 1, because even the Action Comics 1 figure that I supposedly have doesn't completely look like Action Comics 1, because it's got the triangle shield instead of like the shield. So I'm definitely going to get Action Comics number 1 from McFarlane.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. It's, I mean, it'd be so hard to find a toy of that one. You know what I mean?
Yes.
Anything other than a new one.
And McFarlane's also releasing Superman and Doomsday for the 85th anniversary. So, those are the two newest McFarlane things that I've seen posted. All right. Let's see. Is there anything else, James, news-wise that we haven't talked about? I feel like there's something. Is there something?
I know there's an anime trailer for the first DC anime that they announced. There was a line coming. I know you're not going to really watch any of those, but
no, but I do.
It was a Suicide Squad trailer that dropped today.
I know.
Yeah, there's only focus on like Harley Quinn and the Joker.
I know that we talked about we'll cover Night Terror later on as it hits the app. So we might end up just covering it in the fall as part of like October because it'll all be on the app by then.
Yeah, I was going to say, I just read the free comic book day one because they're just starting to come out this week.
But I feel like there's something else that's bigger. Oh, yeah, now I remember. We have a new Superman in Lois Lane, James. We have a new Superman. And James, this is going to make you feel old.
Okay.
You ready? This is the first Superman that's being cast. Superman that is significantly younger than us.
This is true because, you know, the last time Superman was cast, we were about the same age.
Tyler,
as Superman.
Tyler is 2 years younger than me. So that, and you and I are the same age. So you see, you're younger than Brian. and Cavill's 2 years older than us. So that's the same wheelhouse. 2 years is nothing. Now, David here is like 9 years younger than us. So that there's a significance there. But David Cornsweet. I like that. It sounds better than sweat, but whatever. Has been cast as Superman. Now, how are you feeling, James?
The only thing I saw him in, the only thing I would have seen him in, I saw a list of some of his projects was Pearl.
Yeah, that's and what I'm I've pretty sure. So far.
Yeah, and I'm pretty sure that was a very small part.
There's only like three people in that movie. So there's him as the projectionist.
Pearl, yes.
Her neighbor and her parents. It's pretty much the cast.
I did like the projectionist. I mean, I thought he was a good actor with the way that everything was portrayed in that movie. I mean, that's it. And then, I mean, Lois Lane, I have no idea who she is.
Dude, after we get off here, I need you to do this. You just need to go get on Amazon Prime. I know you have Amazon Prime. If you don't, I'll give you my information. Watch just the pilot of The Marvelous Miss Maisel, because Rachel Brosnahan is Lois Lane. You watch that pilot, something magical will happen to you, something that one day you have to tell your son that happens to a man when he sees a woman. and you'll be like, yep, sold. I watched the pilot just when I saw that she was on the short list. I was like, okay, I've not seen her act, so I'm going to watch this show. I watched the pilot. Jenny and I are about to finish the third season tonight.
is she Miss Maisel, or
yes.
Is she just, oh, okay.
She's Miss Maisel.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so you will get a nice dose of her range, and just, you'll immediately be like, yep, I'm sold.
Okay, well, that's great. That's good to hear.
That's your homework, James.
That's my homework, is to watch it.
Yes.
Yeah, it's obviously it's an exciting announcement to have something planned, you know, coming, a new Superman movie coming, with very little, especially foreknowledge of who these people are. Like, I'm just like, okay, let's, I'm definitely excited for the movie as it is. So I'm kind of letting myself roll into what's coming, because I mean, there's no reason to get excited now, because it's like when we got excited for BVS in 2014, and then, you know, they just spoiled everything by the time the movie came out.
Yeah, don't
you know what I mean? Like, yeah, it's just too much just to keep it in the public eye. So I hope we kind of like don't run into something like that for this movie.
Yeah, I feel like it's so weird because, like, you know, there's this huge cry for Henry Cavill back and people crying. And I mean, part of that, you know, we're like, well, that never happened to Brandon Routh when Henry Cavill was cast. Yeah, the situation was different, but we didn't have social media the way we do now. I mean, heck, even the way things were going when Man of Steel came out, like, it wasn't as prominent as it is now. So,
oh yeah, I remember reading all my movie news from an actual movie news website. I went there and I scrolled the website and checked out the articles, because that's how it was when Man of Steel was coming out.
So, I mean, it's a lot different that people can voice their thoughts and opinions now ridiculously fast. So it's a different upbringing. And for anyone who wants to complain about, oh, just it's, you know, David looks like a younger Henry. Okay. He looks like Henry Cavill and Tom Welling got mashed together. Great. That means he looks like Superman.
I mean, okay. Yeah, some of the Henry Cavill him comparison memes I've shared to the group, I think are hysterical.
There's, yeah, I mean, I'll laugh, but it's not true. I mean, and like, you know, my thing is sometimes, and this is leading into our next statement, sometimes you just need a clean break and start over with a fresh face up front, you know,
yeah.
Because as great as Henry is, he's always tied to everything that came before, and they've tried how many little reboots and changes and tweaks for DC and nothing's working. So just starting on a clean slate is what I think they should do, which brings me to my next point. I started hearing this, and what's funny, this is one of those things that Brian mentioned to me that he heard someone say and then forgot that he told me that he heard someone say it. So when I mentioned it back to him, he's like, I told you that. And I was like, yeah. And I'm telling you, I'm hearing more people say it. He's like, huh? Is some people online were talking about, are they going to try to retroactively include the Suicide Squad in Gunn's DC universe and making the Superman that Bloodsport shot be the David Corn Sweat Suite. The David Superman. Just going to call him David for right now.
You know what? I don't see why not.
And, you know, my thing, I thought about that, and I was like, okay, well, that means you would backdoor Peacemaker. Well, Peacemaker shows Superman. Well, not enough. I'm like, it shows him from a distance enough that it could still be whatever the new Superman is. It shows Momoa and Flash. Well, the way they organized the Flash movie to be, I'm pretty sure they weren't counting on Ezra sucking and were counting on him to go forward as Flash in the new films and Momoa to continue as Aquaman. That was the whole point in the Flash post-credit scene. So I could see a world where that means that you probably retroactively then bring... You would almost, if you did something like that, that means you would bring Shazam and Black Adam with you as well. And is that something you want to do? Or do we just want clean slate? You know? Do we just want clean slate and go from there?
What do you think? Yeah, I mean, it's the thing, you know, with the, it's, I guess it's complicated when you talk about us as fans, because we can see that characters are the same person from Earth to Earth, and some are different. You know what I mean? But when it comes to the general audience and all the baggage that comes from beforehand, I mean, possibly, maybe, you could retroactively bring them in. And it still work out, but I don't know that it would be the best thing to do. You know, I mean, we have talked about a clean slate, kind of a total break. But if the idea is to incorporate what's coming, or are they just waiting to see what sticks before they launch the new stuff? You know what I mean?
Right. And I'm just kind of like, yeah, we'll see. Okay, so think about this. 2006 was Superman Returns. 2013 was the release of Man of Steel. That's 7 years. I feel like 7 to 8 years is the sweet spot for a reboot. Okay. Less than that, you start to run into, like, was it 5 years? Was Spider-Man 3 to The Amazing Spider-Man? I think that feels right. Yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
07 to 2012. Yeah.
2012. Yeah.
I feel like, and then Tom Holland, let's see, okay. Just for comparison, Tom Holland was, or Andrew Garfield was 2014 for The Amazing Spider-Man 2. And then 2016 was Civil War. That's 2 years. Okay? That's 2 years. I think that's the fastest turnaround reboot we've ever had on film, like movies. Because 2012 to 2016 was 4 years, and that was for Batfleck. So I'm saying all this because if you look at 2007, 2025, or I'm sorry, not 2007, 2017 to 2025, that is 8 years, right? Yeah, math again. Shit. I mean, shoot. 8 years. And that would be from Henry to David if you don't count, Zack Snyder's Justice League.
Or which wasn't, Black Adam's.
Or the Black Adam post-credit teaser.
Post-credit scene.
The Black Adam post-credit scene is the one that throws off the formula. But if you're just looking at theatrical releases where people, for general audience people, just looking for Superman, it kind of hits that sweet spot. So it's just worth notating. I mean, Joker to Joker from Leto to Ledger was 8 years. And then 16 to... Because then it gets muddy when you look at 2017. Because even, okay, look at this. We look at... this is where it gets funny. 2017 to 2022. 5 years for The Batman. But then Ben Affleck shows up again. So does Michael Keaton this year. So it throws it off. But whatever. Okay? We live in different times. So that's all I got for news. It's time to talk about a little show called Superman and Lois. Superman and Lois has concluded its third season, James. Can you believe we're already at the end of season 3?
No, not really. It almost seems like yesterday we was just watching a super show.
It seems like just yesterday we were excited because Superman was going to be on Supergirl. That was such a good time. Such a good time. And now we're done with the third season of probably the best Superman show ever made. And season 3, what a ride. I'm so happy that we have season 4. And we are going to talk about this in extreme detail. But
yeah, I think so.
So let me bust out my beat for beat notes because I was tasting notes like crazy because I'm like, I can't miss this. This is the end, you know, and we don't know when we're going to get season 4. You know, at the earliest, I'm thinking fall of 2024.
I mean, that's a little ways, you know what I mean?
With the writer's strikes. But I think
fall of... Ah, yeah, you got a point. I was going to say this fall is impossible.
with the writer's strike going on still, and it's starting to cause pushbacks, and then they're going to recalibrate the season. I mean, even if they rushed it, it might be early, like January or February or March of 2024.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I'm hoping for. That's what I want to happen. And it might be another one like this season, for example. By the time episode 2 or 3 aired, they'd already wrapped. So they're already done filming it.
Yeah.
It might end up being one of those where they start airing while they're finishing production, you know? And we go back to one of those cycles where it's like an episode, a week off. 2 episodes, 2 weeks off, you know? It might end up being like that, even though it's going to be 10 episodes.
Right. Well, let's hope if it gives, let's say we're looking at, you know, a full year before it drops. And if you're talking fall, that's over a year.
Yeah.
I mean, they could be well on into production before it even drops. And hopefully we won't look at something like that to kind of destroy the momentum of the final season. Because this season has been the best when it comes to airing the episodes.
Yes.
There was hardly any delays, and if there was, it was 1, maybe 2 weeks.
I think there was 2 times where it was like a 1 week delay. And you know, it definitely, we've talked about before where other CW superhero shows screwed up on the third season. Arrow, especially. Flash third season wasn't bad. I rewatched it recently and it starts to have some things, but it's not bad. And Supergirl season 3 was great. So this season 3 was great. But we knew that they had talked about that this season was going to end on a cliffhanger, and they structured this season beautifully in the sense that if they hadn't got a fourth season, there would have been a huge fan outcry.
Absolutely.
The fans would have lost their mind.
Well, with this cliffhanger, for sure.
Much like Janita lost her mind when she figured out what was happening and she looked at me with big eyes.
Oh, yeah. Jamie lost her mind, too. She was like, no, tell me there's another one. Like, no, that's it. Like, we're stuck now until friggin' season 4 starts. Whatever that may be.
So the episode is called What Kills You Only Makes You Stronger. While Smallville prepares for a meteor shower, Kyle announces surprising news. Lex emerges from hiding and has prepared his revenge for anyone he believes has wronged him. He has also created an unstoppable weapon as the means of ultimate revenge against Superman.
Well, that was pretty apt synopsis.
Yeah, the other one I found was really small and really crappy.
it was pretty concise. I mean, that's the majority of stuff that happens. You know, just details.
So, the episode starts with, it's 32 days since Luther got out of jail. Sam is dating. It's summertime now, but everyone still wears a jacket and looks like it's in fall. That was my favorite. And the greatest shorthand for any writer ever to show a woman is if she wakes up in the morning and immediately runs to the bathroom and throws up at the smell of food. What is that, James?
Oh, it's morning sickness.
What does morning sickness mean, James?
She's pregnant.
She's pregnant. And who is she, James?
She is Chrissy Beppo.
So, Kyle, buddy, got some advice for you. Snippity snip. Okay? I'm just saying, buddy. Shouldn't need to lock that down, but Chrissy is pregnant with Kyle's offspring. An interesting, easy way to write these characters off. Hmm. And then, so we have that awkward, interesting conversation between Chrissy and Kyle about they're going to have a baby. How did you feel about that, James?
You know, I guess since I've been like happy with the characterization, the character interactions since they've been going out, I would say that I'm happy for them. Cool. Yeah, it was okay. It wasn't something I was like, oh my God, they're pregnant.
I was like, oh great, Kyle. Whose else's life are you gonna screw up?
I was like, this is gonna be interesting when he tells the family. Which in my opinion was surprisingly like happy and upbeat.
Like, what are you gonna do? Okay, like, you might as well just be positive and upbeat about it, you know?
Well, I mean, he ended, the relationship got ended 2.5 years ago. They found out about the cheating in the first season. So, the entire third season, the entire second season.
Well, they found out in the second season.
Was it the second season?
Yeah, at the quinceañera. I know it's been that long, James, but it was in the second season.
Well, I haven't rewatched them, so I just couldn't remember if that was the if that happened in the first season. I thought that happened in the
It's because the first season ends like in the happy barbecue where we're all like, "Man, we like Kyle." They didn't do stereotypical man things. Then season two rolls around, they're like, "There he goes, Kyle was out cheating." Man, they did that stereotypical drunk man things.
Gotcha.
And you, Kyle.
Okay. Well, so yeah, season and a half.
And I mean, that also time, you know, however much time goes.
Has passed. Yeah.
So we, and meanwhile, so we have the scene where Kyle tells, the, like you said, the family, and they're upbeat. And we find out that him and Lana had always talked about she wanted a third child. And that's not going to happen, or is it? But I kind of laughed at Jania, like they want a Lana wanted a third child. She didn't take care of her second child that comes and disappears on the show. It just randomly disappears and no one's watching.
Yeah.
So how you don't have a baby? You know, it's messed up.
Well, I mean, they certainly were not in the place for a baby when we dropped in on them in the first season.
Oh, no, 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 no. But so while we have Kyle and Chrissy discussing that they're going to have a baby, Lana gets asked out on a date by who, James?
By John Henry Irons.
Yeah, huh? Yeah, buddy.
Yes, they do.
And then moving on, then, like I said, we got beat for beat notes, basically. Sam Lane comes to John Henry and says that the DOD is going to buy more tech from him, and basically they're going to exclusive contract, and he needs to move to Metropolis, and they drop the name of what, James?
Steelworks.
Steelworks.
Nat says they can finally open Steelworks.
And that Nat could go to the DOD Academy where a certain someone just enrolled. Mateo.
Yeah, Mateo.
I like that little bit of continuity with Mateo coming back. I think it'd be kind of cool if Mateo like turns around and came back, you know, in the guest appearance in some way down the line. And then we found there's a meteor shower in Smallville. That's never good news, James. I was like,
well, I think it's being able to see a meteor shower. From Smallville.
Yeah.
Who cares? It's not crashing into Smallville like we're used to.
It doesn't matter, dude. The terms meteor shower, Smallville together, not good.
Yeah. I mean, it brings up a whole mess of stuff.
But But we see that they're having it like in downtown, and like John Kent's out there setting up chairs, trying to impress the coach, and the coach is like yelling at him, and no matter what he does, the coach is not going to forgive him for him losing his football season. Coach is kind of a jerk, but I guess I get it, you know? Like, kids mess up, man. They're teenagers. Move on, dude.
Yeah, he was a jerk to him this episode. I don't know. I don't blame him because it is a big... It ruined the whole season. It's not like it just you know, hurt John and his family. Like, it hurt a lot of people who were innocent in the whole thing, who were just doing their best.
Yeah.
In something they enjoyed doing.
It would have been hilarious if he was like, but coach, I'm different now. I'm like a new person. That was the old me. This is the new me. Just kind of like a meta joke. Like, we get it, dude. We get it.
Yes, it's me. Get over it. Move on.
But then we get Chrissy, Clark, and Lois in, what do you call it? The paper. And they're all wearing like black and green combos. I thought that was interesting. But, you know, she tells them she's pregnant. And then Clark hears that Judge Regan has been murdered.
The judge who put Luther away.
Which was, yes, who was also earlier in the season, the one that was going to kill herself that Lois talked off the ledge.
Oh, okay. The one who, they did say that Bruno had been blackmailing her.
Yes.
So.
Now, we'll pause for a second here. No, wait, I'll ask this question a little bit. I'll hold my thoughts. We do see the Daily Planet and the globe on the Daily Planet while they go to Metropolis. One of my favorite lines is, so I think I missed a beat in my notes because it was getting intense, but Clark and Lois spend their first time as a married couple's intimacy together since the incident.
Since her surgery.
Yes. And they don't just enjoy the farm. No, he flies her to a special place in Italy. It's a villa.
Yes, Tall's villa.
And they have a beautiful moment together. A lot of beautiful moments in this episode. And then I bring that up because they come back and Lois and Clark tell the boys, they're at dinner, that they want to take a family trip to Italy for the summer. And they're like, what? And they mention Uncle Tal's villa.
Yeah. And they said, you're trying to bribe us. It's working.
Clark talks about getting matching t-shirts.
Oh my God, Clark is such a dork. I love Tyler's Clark. He's such a dork. He's such a dork. He's such a nerd.
It's my favorite Clark. And yeah. The line after, Dad, don't go all Griswold on us.
Yes. Yeah, you can't. You're not going to go full Griswold.
I missed it because the kids and Gina's like, back it up. You have to hear what he says. And I like back it up like, yes. And so we have that set up. Okay. And I think that's cool. You have Jordan who basically don't want him to use his powers. And Sam tells to Clark that anger that he has, don't let it last. Work with him because it's only going to get worse if he just has him repress it. And they, you know, they tell Jordan that he can use his powers to help fly to Italy. And then John and Lois step outside while Clark talks with Jordan about this stuff with Sarah. Has a little father-son conversation. And you know, he basically tells her, he tells him to make up, fix it. And Jordan goes over and talks to Sarah and tries to work on it. And I'm proud of him. I wanted to high five him.
Yeah. It's tough. They didn't like promise to try and be friends, but they at least tried to to smooth things over so they could at least be friendly.
I'm going to give this piece of advice, okay? This is now, I'm putting my dad hat on here, okay? If you date a woman that you claim that you love, and then you break up and say, let's be friends, you need time. You need to stay away from each other. You got to heal from the love, okay? You need to back up because you're going to have mixed emotion. You can't just all of a sudden drop it and go into friendship mode or be comfortable seeing other people around them. You need to separate and then bridge back together later on. I'm saying that as someone who's experienced things in life, but as a dad who will one day probably have to depart this wisdom on my son upstairs or my daughter, you can't just go straight into friendship. It doesn't work. And that was their problem, was Sarah just tried to play off, well, we're just friends now. We're friends. Friends. And you can't do that to him. It's not fair. It's not right for either of you. You got to have time. You know, him being gone over the summer, good example of time to come back and then repair the friendship and heal. Okay? Taking the dad hat off, putting the Superman Krypton Report hat back on. Okay?
So. Speaking of dads, though, Clark, again, like, the writing so good. Just the way he is able to talk with them, being extremely serious, but also, you know, with a little brevity, getting the point across, being able to discuss it and teach a lesson.
Yeah.
About Jordan using his powers. I can use my powers to do this, but I can't use my powers to save people. And then, you know, if you're doing it for fame and pictures and stuff, like, you know, that stuff is just going to come. But why you're doing it is the important part.
It's kind of like I have this love hate with people who do good deeds, but make sure that they're filmed and it's posted online to go viral. It's like, are you really doing the good deed because it needs to be done? Or are you just doing to get the attention that people give you because you did a good deed?
Right. But it is also, I mean, that's a fine line you walk. You know what I mean? Because it's important that those good deeds are seen by as many people as possible. So that
And I think that's where it comes into me.
Reciprocate, but also it's like, why are you doing it?
And if it's someone else,
it should still be done.
Like, if it's someone else recording it and reporting it and publishing it, it's one thing,
right?
But when it's like you, like, hey man, film me doing this, I can put it on my channel. That's when I get a little iffy about things. But you were talking about, speaking of dads, so the girl that Sam's dating, who I discovered the actress is the original Sue Storm. Not Jessica Alba, people. Mm-hmm. Sue Storm from the Fantastic Four movie that was shelved by Roger Corman and never to be released is here. And she's getting a little hot and heavy with Sam. She pulls him off into the alley, making out, takes his phone. And then all of a sudden people show up in a van and take Sam. I felt bad for him. Finally gets out there and starts dating. It also shows that, one, her power, because he would have run background checks. You know, he would have run a background check on any woman he was going to date. And for it to pass DOD clearance in his mind, for him to date, something's up. But Sam is taken. His phone is left behind. I did like, okay, how did you feel about him introducing Natalie as his granddaughter?
You know, I believe a lot that family is not necessarily, the people you're related to.
I don't, you know, friends. I got family.
All right, Vin Diesel, calm down.
You know, if you say if you say family six times in a mirror in the dark, Vin Diesel appears. Because it's all about family.
And Family is definitely about those closest to you and who you care about and who cares about you.
I wrote a line in a script once. The line was, "The family of bond and the family of blood." And my teacher was like, "I don't understand what that means." And I was like, "The family of blood, the people you're related to, and the people that you bond and love along the way that you make family. How hard is that, teach?"
Yeah. Because, I mean, for a lot of people, and for a lot of people, a lot of their family, the people they see most often, is people they've bonded with.
Yeah. It's true. We speak truth, okay? James's family, if James needs something, I'd be there. We've done the blood rituals, we've sacrificed cats together, you know, we've checked the boxes, man. You know, the candlelight ceremony, all that fun stuff.
Oh yeah. Yep. cut and bled and, you know.
Then shook hands like Arnold Schwarzenegger and Carl Weathers.
Yeah.
It wasn't as epic, but you get the idea.
Exactly, yeah.
It looked more like Randall and Dante, but whatever. So poor Sam is taken. And James is absolutely correct about the people that you meet along the way. And it's important in life. You know, I try to tell that to my kids, like, family's important, but family doesn't always mean the people that you're born into. It's a lesson to learn. I wondered if she was
Yeah, it's a hard lesson to learn because, you know, sometimes you're forced to learn that lesson.
Amen.
You know,
I wondered if she was Lillian.
So those who aren't, I mean, that's great.
Yeah. I thought, is she Lillian? You know? But I don't think so. I don't think so. I don't think they ever gave her a name.
I thought I hit mute, but maybe I missed it. I apologize. No, her name was Gretchen.
Okay, I must have missed it.
Yeah.
So that's what's happening to Sam. And then 33 days ago, James. This is where the episode does a nice twist. And I thought about this, okay? Would I have liked to have seen this? Or would I have liked the reveal, then cut back to this? I don't know. I thought about it. But 33 days ago, what happened 33 days ago, James?
That is the day that Luther got picked up by Otis and left the farm and went and found Bizarro in Bruno Mannheim's tunnels, where we find out that Bizarro just ripped off Otis's ear.
Yes.
Didn't kill him like it kind of sounded like maybe he did.
Yeah.
Because I was wondering how Otis dies and Luther lives with Bizarro. You know what I mean?
Exactly. I was like, this is like Dawn of the Dead. So
I mean, yeah, it pretty much was.
So we see Luther, he uses some sort of weird like crypto gun like thing to start killing.
Well, I think it's XK.
That's okay. I think so too. That's what I thought too. And it makes me want to go back and watch season 2 about how the XK was working with him.
Excuse me. Yeah, because it was the XK that he was that weakened him, right?
I thought so. Like, but or did, because the XK worked different on him.
Yeah, I thought it was his weakness.
And we see basically Luther kill him and he comes back to life. Kills him, comes back to life. Guns, different kinds of axes, torture. They hang him up with chains. And
he keeps getting... So the interesting thing was, yeah, he after he kills him, they hang him up with chains, and then he asks him, you know, like, let me kill you so you can be stronger. And I mean, the interesting thing being is like, why would Bizarro do this? You know, why would he, when he was kind of like hero-ish when he died?
I mean, I equate it to the fact that he died, straight up died, and then came back to life, and his mind was not right.
Yeah, I think between being dead, coming back, and the idea that, like, in the comics, Bizarro goes bad back and forth for one reason or another.
You know, when I thought we were going to get, like, more of the zombie kind of classic Bizarro here, you know, at first. And it just, he keeps getting tortured and, you know, killed. And like Jania points out, like, that's Lex's power of getting inside your mind and breaking your psyche.
Right.
But he keeps killing him and bringing him back. And what happens? What does he become?
Well, he turns into Doomsday. He turns into a version of Doomsday.
Right.
With like XK spikes and stuff.
Jania looks over me and she goes, are they making him Doomsday? Like, her eyes got huge and was just like, and then looked back like, oh my God. And, you know, we see them feed him an entire cow, but we don't see like what happens to the cow, or like he's just in the train car underground. And we see that they take the ELT from Sam. Now I figure Sam's dead. I have a good, I'm pretty much feeling Sam's dead. That's how they're going to like get him off the show, is they killed him here. If we don't see it, like when the show comes back, I'm pretty sure Sam's going to get killed in this event. So what we have is Luther, you know, this is, I put in my notes, like, this is what happens while you do those episodes without a lot of superpowering, just drama, so you can save your budget for this. And this is the cliffhanger right here. The last few minutes of the episode, we have Luther show up at the farm, and Superman shows up at the Kent farm, and Luther signals for Doomsday, and it's a epic battle.
Yeah. The one thing that gets me about this Luther is just like how it is very Luther, you know what I mean? It's how freaking arrogant he is. Like, I told her that I was innocent and shit, you know what I mean? It's like, I told her, so she should have believed me when she was following the evidence. It's like that's it. Like, she stole it. I told her, she should have believed me. Like, it doesn't matter anything else. His word was all that was necessary.
And I mean, for me to, on this Luther, like, I really need some, like, flashbacks in the next season to see him before he goes to jail. Just to really try to figure out this Luther. Because right now he feels like such a different version of Luther that I haven't really connected in my mind that he is Luther, if that makes sense.
Yeah. He's only been in two episodes, and they've done everything in their power to try and make him like the most menacing and manipulative and scary without doing much. You know what I mean?
Yep.
And it's certainly to another level.
So what did you think of the look of Doomsday when he showed up? Like, he busts into the barn and comes walking out in the fire, and you just have Superman hovering there. What did you think of his look?
Well, it's funny you brought up Nemesis for Two-Face earlier, because I think he looked very much like a tyrant from Resident Evil. Like with the different size arms, like being asymmetrical, not being mm-hmm. built the same. And I thought it was kind of cool how he still had the Bizarro S on him.
Yeah.
And then the XK spikes were something interesting and unique.
I think it was I liked his look, except for his face. His face looks a little weird and wonky. I really like the face of still the Smallville Doomsday.
Yeah.
Because I think it looks more like Doomsday, but this one, I like the size. It's big enough without being too big. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like BVS, a little too big. Okay. This Doomsday, man, it works. And he shows up in the barn and he's got the XK spikes and he's just hulking.
Yeah. I thought the very last shot of him looked really awesome when they're on the moon. Charging each other. Doomsday almost looks like stop motion. It almost looks like something physically being used. So I thought the effects were pretty good. I mean, like you said, his face, it does have a CG look to it, the way he roars and the way his like face elongates and stuff. But other than that, it was really cool. I thought it was a really cool looking Doomsday.
Well, we have the scene where Superman gets thrown into downtown Metropolis and then Doomsday lands and you see the crowd reacting. Oh yeah, we also Kyle proposed to Chrissy. They're getting married. Who cares? Superman pops up and tells John and John Henry no. And Jania looks at me at this scene. She goes, there is so much communicated between Clark looking at Lois and Lois looking at Clark. And you just see the fire coming out of Doomsday's mouth slowly. And he goes flying with him. I look at Jania and I'm like, this is where I would say, Jordan, to the fortress, Phantom Zone projector, go. I'm like, go get it. Go now. You know? But dude, they're just, Doomsday is plummeting him, beating him, throwing him. Unless they fly to Metropolis, because we're still operating in that. How far away is Metropolis from Smallville territory? Because, you know, it seems like it's closer and closer each season.
Well, this Doomsday can fly.
That's what I'm saying. This Doomsday is the scariest, most powerful. Okay, now follow me here. Doomsday in the comics, they cloned Doomsday, they killed him, they cloned him again. Okay? Cloned Doomsday, killed him, cloned him again. That's how he was able to. Every time they'd kill him, they'd bring him back and they would torture him. They'd mess with the genetics and they kept doing it. So it tore up his psyche and everything. And that's kind of the Krypton version of Doomsday. Okay? BVS was General Zod's dead corpse brought back to life with the Kryptonian deformity, making him Doomsday. Okay? This Doomsday and Smallville's Doomsday, we actually see him die and then resurrect and not be able to die again that way. So this Doomsday, we are seeing, as we see here in a moment, when Clark impales him, he dies and then he gets up because he can't die like that again and he's back. You know, you think about them, what they were trying to do with Bizarro's blood. Regeneration, right? Superman's healing, using Bizarro, pseudoscience, whatever Mannheim did, to fix cancer cells, which is regenerating cells. So he is healing himself. So is there a way, James, to stop this Doomsday? Because what is, after Doomsday kills Superman, what's Lex going to do? What's the
that's plan? You know, that's always the concern. Like, what is the plan? And are we going to see the death of Superman? Do you think we are?
Hold that thought. Okay, once we finish how this ends, we'll talk about what our thoughts for. And I'll tell you my theory here. I'm actually got I got it playing as we talk. Just the last 10 minutes here. He uses, you know, his freeze breath on Doomsday. And then we see Doomsday starting to use his fire breath. So this Doomsday is more powerful because he regenerates right there. But because he's coming from a Kryptonian host, instead of being, you know, the way they do it, he has the heat vision or cold vision. And he can fly. So he is, you know, that's something we've seen more recently where Doomsday has more of standard Kryptonian powers. We see Jordan can still hear and see what's going on. Now, this scene here, Clark, you know, he drops down. He's telling everyone not to worry. He thinks Doomsday's dead. But then slowly Soundgarden starts to play. Mm. Blow up the outside. Guess what song Solomon put on his playlist and was playing with his Doomsday and Superman toy too? This song.
Yeah.
Dude, he loved it, man. Like the song. And he sat and watched this part with me and Jania, his eyes as wide as mine and Jania's as we were watching Superman battle Doomsday and everything right here. Solomon, actually, he's here.
Hi, guys. I love this battle, by the way. This was a great battle.
Sayla's here, too. We're watching it with me. But
we're not really watching. We're trying to look for Mom because we're trying to tell her there's fireworks.
Okay, yeah. So Superman goes flying up the building. And Doomsday takes him down, man. Like, if they go down underground, he's beating him. I mean, it's brutal.
Yeah, he's doing some two-handed smashes.
Now, what did the XK do for regulars like Superman?
I don't really think it had much of an effect on him. Crap. Because the effect that it had was... Because the effect it had was getting people... Was helping people to...
Get powers.
Be eradicated.
Because my thought was, you know, Doomsday here has XK in him. So what does that do? And how Doomsday sparks the gas on the subway, you know, as they're fighting just looks awesome. I'm going to say this is the best Superman versus Doomsday battle. Okay, BVS is good. It's really good. But you also have Wonder Woman and Batman in there too. But just Superman versus Doomsday, like live action, this is the best. Smallville, you're the worst. Okay.
Yeah, that is 100% accurate with Smallville being the worst.
I like this shot right here of his suit because you actually see the symbol on his chest. This season is 3D. With Doomsday, you're like beating his chest. And then the kid on the street wearing the Superman t-shirt, seeing Superman getting beat by Doomsday, man. As Doomsday just flies up. Takes him into the sky, and we have Clark. Like, I love this scene right here. You know, Jordan says, I can't hear him breathing anymore. I'm very surprised we didn't get more of a scene of like John Henry, like in his Wesley Snipes Blade shirt, getting his suit and going up there, or Jordan ready to go. But them going in space and Clark just like thinking about the boys, Lois. You know, the theme of this season being like facing death. You know what I'm saying? This whole season's been about Lois facing death. And now it's Clark facing death. You know, it ends in like a strange bookend and just him not accepting that he's going to be beat. Making that fist and then breaking free and just, oh, it's so good, man.
Yes, it's been a very, very well done episode.
The fly punch behind shot, and now they're on the moon.
Yeah, that was awesome. Sending him flying to the moon. And at this point, Doomsday pulls out a couple of his XK spikes, and they lock eyes and charge at one another.
And, like, this whole time I'm thinking to myself, like, I know it's not going to end the way we think it is. Because they said it ends on a cliffhanger. So I'm like, it's not going to end the way we think. And they just go flying at each other. And this shot of them, like, approaching each other is now my computer back screen.
Is it?
Yeah, Doomsday flying towards Superman, him flying, and then just Superman and Lois. And I was just like, oh. Solomon's like, huh, what's the next episode? I'm like, that's it, bud. He's like, what? I'm like, that's it, man. That's the episode for now. Like, until season four. Like, that's a cliffhanger. Now.
like, you know what? That's how we grew up watching TV. Was cliffhanger, season finales, and we didn't even get the shows come back.
Could you imagine if it was not renewed and that's how they ended the series?
I would be frustrated.
Fandom would destroy DC. Now, your question was, do we think they'll do the death of Superman? I could see them doing two things. One, the next episode picks up right where this lives off, or we pick up at a point. Maybe Clark is dead. And we pick up at his funeral or the day after or something. And then the battle's told through us through flashbacks of different people as they watched. And then maybe we do half of next season with Clark being dead and then he comes back.
I don't know about half the season. I am curious.
It's only 10 episodes, so like four or five episodes.
Well, we have John Henry. We have a version of Superboy.
But what? We know that John Henry's going to be a guest star. You know what I'm saying? So I'm wondering if he'll destroy Doomsday, but he'll be like beat up bad. And it'll be about Jordan like taking up the mantle of Superboy and like really putting himself out there. So, I mean, I think there's ways to do it. Or you could start and just have a huge battle as the, you know, the next episode begins and it's a Jordan gets up there, John Henry gets up there, you know, Matt gets up there, Tal comes out of nowhere, all of a sudden Kara shows up, you know, we find out she comes from the Legion with Mon-El and they're all like fighting Doomsday. I'm very interested to see. I mean, they have a way of subverting our expectations, telling us what they're going to do, but then us not believing it. I mean, the fake out when Doomsday showed up.
Yeah, the fake out when Bizarro showed up.
That's what I mean.
At the beginning of season two, like, I've been on record saying how that was just, it frustrates me that that's a fake out like that, because it's a Doomsday introduction, and the containment suit is much larger than people. And Bizarro is the same size as Tyler, and he's just the same size as people. But that containment suit is huge, like Doomsday should be. So it was very.
it's a tricky scene.
It was a tricky scene, but now, I mean, maybe if it was planned, they're like, oh, well, it's a foreshadow because he is going to be Doomsday one day.
I'm watching the scene now, okay? And when he first comes walking out, yeah, he looks huge.
Mm-hmm.
But as that battle goes on, I'm watching it right now. So as the battle goes on, he gets normal sized.
That's what I mean. Like, it was a fake out. It was, at the time, it was very much like, aha, look, you think it's Doomsday, but it's not.
It's like there's like two shots of him looking massive, like big, but it's just tricky camera work. That was what I, you know what I'm saying? But the fact, like we said, like it's set, it's planting the seed, it's showing us something, and it's building, and then they paid it off here in the third season. So it was Doomsday, just it went by bizarro, you know?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I guess when you look at it as a whole, I mean, it's an interesting foreshadow. You know,
and that's what they do so beautifully on this show. I have a theory how he'll defeat Doomsday. Do you want to hear it?
Yes.
This is the Doomsday built from Bizarro. Bizarro gets weaker by our sun. They're in space. I think he's going to throw him into the sun. And he'll just his cells will just eradicate and burn up before they can regenerate. Mm. That's the only thing I can think that makes sense. Because they've shown us he can't like break his neck, like we've seen and everything, like in the animated film and stuff. And the fact that it's coming from Bizarro, I feel like because Bizarro is the reverse on things, that's the only thing that would really be able to destroy him and eradicate him.
Yeah.
Or they put him in the Phantom Zone.
I guess that's the only two options, really. Because the only ways they've been able to defeat Doomsday post killing him is sending him to the end of time, so that way he's destroyed by entropy. And containing him by having him consistently split between multiple transporters, so he's never whole.
So, and I feel like my theory just works better with the show. So, I don't know. Or they just send him to Earth too, you know, the square Earth, and just let him ravish that Earth. Talro just comes and gets him, throws him back, like, go! Or, you know, Sisko shows up, like, and they're like, who are you? He's like, I'm Sisko. And sends him to Earth X, the dead Earth. Or, not Earth X, what was it? I don't know, whatever was the dead Earth, they sent the gas in the Flash. That's where they put him. And he just is on a planet by himself, just beating the planet. But no, like I feel like it's gonna be something like that, like throwing him into the sun. So, but all I know is that's a cliffhanger. It's exciting. I'm looking forward to season four. I know Solomon is.
I am.
So we'll probably mull over this idea more and more as things go on. But what any other final thoughts, James?
Not really. I mean, I think we covered it pretty heavily. You know, yeah, it was great. Yeah, it was a really good finale. I'm really interested in how they plan on going about it. You know, are they going to do the death of Superman? I'm more interested in certainly what's to come. Leaving it on a cliffhanger, the story's not done. The episode was a great episode. They really do give you kind of a setup. He has a lot of reconciliation with his family in this episode. Him and Lois get intimate together, something she's been very scared of, especially since her surgery. So there's a lot of familial ties cinched in this episode, and then it's like leave you on a cliffhanger. Is he gonna die or not at the hands of Doomsday?
And I hope they don't do a death of Superman. Like, honestly, I feel like we've got that, you know, in the film, but I feel like this, if you are gonna do the death of Superman, this is where you do it, because I feel the stakes are much higher and deeper with this Superman than, you know, in Man of Steel, BBS. Yeah.
But how do you stop this Doomsday if he kills Superman? And then
it has to be something where he throws him into the sun, and then
he collapses and dies, kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah. and then falls back to Earth, kind of like, you know, Superman Returns type thing.
Yeah, maybe he takes one of those XK spikes through the chest, and but he's able to launch him off with enough force before, you know, to send him into the sun before he plummets back to the planet.
Because I could see a really good scene of like Jordan, like him falling, and Jordan flying up there and grabbing him, and with the XK inside of him, maybe like we do something where he's stabbed with XK, and he's falling. Jordan saves him, but he's depowered, and you know they're waiting like we had before. Like he's, you know, he's got to heal. He's not healing. You know what I'm saying? And he's in a coma, and I mean they think he's dead, but I prefer not to do the he's dead route.
Yeah, lots of different ways to like take him off the board, I guess. I do think it is kind of cool. Like I said, they have a Steel and a Superboy in there. I mean, it would be interesting if they did somehow do a Cyborg Superman. If they kind of went a Reign of the Superman route as a small storyline.
I mean, that's a way you could have Tyler there and not be him. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I definitely would like in season 4 John Henry to get the S on his suit and some tweaks to his Steel suit. I want the cape and I want the S symbol crest on him, and I want Jordan to have a proper suit. And I feel like this is the best point to do that. So,
yeah.
Thoughts?
Well, with all the subverting of expectations and things, I really, really wonder what their plans are, what the end game is, and how they plan to get there.
And, you know, if season 4 is good, if, like, I wanted 5 seasons. And, you know, 5 solid seasons.
If we get 4 really good, really great seasons.
Because my, you know, my working theory has always been that the show will end before Superman Legacy. So you really have this new breath of DC. And with the writer's strike holding everything back, I wonder if we'll just get one more season. But if it's one really good season, okay. You know what I'm saying? All right. But it's a great show. It truly is. And we are lucky. We are so gifted to have it. So, but that is our thoughts right now. We will be mulling that over for a while as we think about Doomsday and comics and Superman and everything that there is to go. And we will be back with a new super show that is coming to you. So it's fun. It'll be the 4th show that we're covering on this podcast. You in Superman land.
Well, so. What a time to be alive, because before this, there was nothing. Before these 4 shows, it was a dark age.
Before time began, there was the cube. Yeah. So, all right. Thanks for listening. Check out the Krypton Report. All of our social media, James and I will be out fighting crime, saving the people of Metropolis from forces of evil. So remember,
look up in the sky.
We just want to say, if you've enjoyed this podcast, please check out other podcasts on the Press Play Podcast Network.
Hello, Brooks here with the Books with Brooks monthly book club podcast. Here's how Books with Brooks works. We read one book a month, and then we talk about it. Classics like Stephen King's The Shining, debut novels like We Are the Brennans by Tracy Lang, and tons of other compelling, life-changing stories, one book and one month at a time. So come read along with us, and then listen in.
Before we start this episode of Krypton Report, I want to take a moment and just give a shout-out here to our Patreon. I know what you're thinking. Gosh, everyone's asking for money, and I get it. But our Patreon is only $1. $1 a month, it helps us keep the podcast going. And what we do is we try to find interesting shows and topics and whatever we want to talk about. We've done, as of this little thing, our last recordings were on the Scream series. Brian and Tyler, that's me, do our own show where we record in the car, and it's kind of funny. And we talk about pop culture or whatever is going on.
We also have the Supernatural podcast we've been reworking. It's taken some time just because of life. But we do movie commentaries as well. It's something that James and I have done, what we used to do on the main show that we've started doing here. So for $1 a month on our Patreon, you can get those shows. There's at least four a month. Also, there's my movie pitch show that I do. But also, what we want is if you're a Patreon, you can come on. You can come on the main show if you want. Or if there's something you want to come on and talk about, we can do it as a Patreon special. So all I want is for $1 a month, think about chipping in, joining our Patreon, and you have a voice to be a part of things. Follow the link in the link tree or in the show notes below, patreon.com/KryptonReport.
If you are like Tyler and James and can't get enough Super Talk, check out these other podcasts. Digging for Kryptonite, Supergirl Radio, The Last Sons of Krypton, The Superboy Legacy Podcast, All-Star Superfans, Superman the Animated Podcast, The Aspiring Kryptonians, Always Hold On to Smallville, The Geek of Steel, and Truth, Justice, and Hope.
Remember to check out Krypton Report on all social media platforms. Go to linktree.com/KryptonReport. You find all of our
reports. This is Dan Jurgens, and if you want to have a good time, keep listening to the Krypton Report.